Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Thank you. You can be seated. You know, the Bible says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. One of the traditions that we started many years ago when I was doing the Wednesday night Bible studies is we would have one or two testimonies that would come forth. And you know what testimonies do is they just stir your faith up and make you connect the miracles in your life to what Jesus is doing or has done. Sometimes we just forget to thank him for the little things, you know, the surprise that we actually made it here without incident or accident. We assume that we're going to make it home all right. But you know, that's because God is doing good things. He's faithful to us, and sometimes we need to testify in church about the faithfulness of God. And I ran across a testimony on that started on a Wednesday night, and then again on a Sunday night. And Charvis, are you in the room? Come on up, Charvis. That's you. Let's give Charvis a good God bless you. And why don't you just take 2 minutes and tell people what God has been doing in your life?
Good evening, family. Good evening, family. All right, it's good to be here. As you all know, I'm wearing a medical tag on my arm. My son just had surgery. I hope my wife don't, well, you know, she's okay with this. According to medical records, it was reported that my son has sickle cell disease. According to medical records. Notice I didn't say he has sickle cell disease. I say according to medical records. So my son had to go in for surgery the last couple of days. He had to have, he had to be circumcised and some other things had to be done. So the doctor said to me, well, he needs to have a blood transfusion. We respect the medical people in their field. Thank God for them. We really appreciate this. And I said, he had to have a blood transfusion. Oh, okay. So I went back and prayed about it. The Lord told me, no, he doesn't need that. Went back to the doctor, we discussed it again, and I told him no. The funny thing about faith, when you have faith, fear does not sit on the sideline. Fear comes and attack you hard. You know, you have to think about, there's a scripture in the Bible, 2 Corinthians 10:5. You really have to cast down those imaginations for real that really attacks you. So everything came to my mind about, well, what would happen if your son does not get this blood transfusion? The worst thing, he could die, he could have a stroke, he could have a heart attack, all these side effects. Went to my life group, we prayed. So if you're not part of a life group, plug in. You need to be part of one. We prayed, felt the spirit. To make a long story short, my son didn't get blood transfusion, came out perfect. To the point, guess what? The doctor came in this morning and saw my wife scratching his head, going, wow. Well, he did very good. The boy came out so great that evening. He was already standing up laughing, and you wouldn't even think he had surgery. So I am so glad to be part of a ministry that believes in faith, that rejects fear. And if you're not, again, part of a life group, join it. Because not only that, we're believing that not only this, that my son is healed, completely healed from that disease. Amen? God bless you, family. Pastor, we love you, man, and thank you. And we love your wife as well. And Beltha, we love you too.
Praise God.
I don't want to take anything away from anyone else. Now, that was one testimony I knew of, and then sometimes I'll just do one spontaneous. If in the next 3 seconds, if you raise your hand, only one of you, that you have a testimony, especially about God's goodness in terms of health, I will receive it. If not, I'm going to move on with service. One, two, and three. God bless you. Lord, I pray as we get into the word tonight that you would help us to hear you clearly, that you would give me clear articulation of speech and revelation of the scripture that will preach exactly what you need to be said, nothing less, nothing more. I thank you, Lord, for in advance, giving us the miracles that are recorded in your word. So when we see them, I think that we will have the faith to grab them and to use them. And I pray, God, that they would be change agent. The word would be a change agent in our life today. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. Shane, do I need to grab the mic or it's going to be all right? Okay. It's a little, if you don't hear, it's a little whistle out here or something. It's a whistler. Okay, our key scripture. Now, first of all, I know it's prayer tonight. Like, this is our annual prayer where we would spend most of the time praying. But we're going to pray at the end no matter what, even if I close at the service and I'm just praying for you. But I want to give you some word to hang on to as we pray. I think it'll be instrumental in helping you. I just want to remind you that Ephesians 6, our key scripture, what is it? Did I have a reader tonight? Okay, you up again. But I'll just go ahead and and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayer and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador and in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Prayer, remember, should be Spirit-inspired, Spirit-led. It should be on every occasion. It should be with every type of request and every type of style, prayer of commitment, prayer of dedication, prayer of binding, prayer of loosing. You should always be alert. You should keep on praying. You should pray for the Lord's people. You should pray for the Lord's servant. You should pray for the gospel to be active and alive. You and I in this house have a responsibility to pray. What we've been trying to achieve over the last several weeks is helping you be sensitive to the power that is in prayer. The first week, as a quick 30-second review, we gave you three key words to help you remember. Just shout them out if you remember what they were. And great students. And what about last week? That's good. And the other shy people in the room, don't be shy. Don't be shy, students. Okay, we're going to be in Matthew 8, 1 through 4. I mean, really to the 17th verse. And there are three things I'm going to help you see. That God answers the prayer of those who call on him, especially when it pertains to healing. God answers the prayer of those who call on him, especially when it pertains to healing.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Okay, thank you. All right. The second point would be God answers the prayers that are full of confidence. Confidence, equating faith. And you might be surprised tonight as to how little it takes to demonstrate confidence in the Lord and get him to respond. The third thing is, if you don't know how to call on him and you don't have confidence, I've got good news for you. The scripture is going to show you that he's still concerned about you, and he'll interrupt your situation that you won't bring to him with confidence. So even if you don't get the prayer points, how to call on him, how to have confidence, I'm going to prove to you in scripture that God is concerned about you and I to the degree that he'll answer anyway. He's going to answer anyway. Not answer, he's going to just jump in your business without you asking. All right. Verse 1. When he came down from the mountain, great crowds followed him. Somebody said since we moved into the church, they had told me, they said, you know, Pastor James, it feels a little crowded. It's a lot of people. I said, you know what? We're just trying to be like Jesus. Trying to be like Jesus. It's okay to have a crowd. Jesus had not only a crowd following him, he had an intimate group of believers following him. Then he had 12, then he had 4, then he had 1. The one thing you want to know about Jesus whenever he talks about a crowd is that the crowds qualify, but they weren't the only style of ministry that he did. And he, in verse 2, and behold, a leper came to him. Let's stop there. Here is the first time we have an indication that there is a problem, and it comes in front of Jesus. This is a leper. Leprosy was a disease you did not want to get. It was contagious. Anybody that you knew that had leprosy, you needed to stay 6 feet away from them at all times. If the wind was blowing, you needed to stay 45 feet away from them at all times. A leper is not someone that you would even touch, you would look at, or you would talk to. A leper was not someone who hung out in public because their disease was debilitating over time. It lasted somewhere between 20 and 30 years. The leprosy may have taken on a form where it affected your muscular system and your bone structure. It causes a person's hand to spaz up and look like a claw. It causes you to have ulcers on your skin, on your fingers, on your toes. People lose fingers, they lose toes, and eventually they die. In fact, the Catholic priest would consider someone with leprosy the walking dead, and they would come in and they would pronounce over them, and they would put the curse. So you done, That's it. And they would actually perform a funeral for you while you were alive. Leprosy is something that I think is akin to sin. When we have sin in our life, is that thing that it contagious? It's debilitating over time. It makes you the walking dead. I just wanted to let you know. See, Jesus can fix all your situations. You might not have leprosy, but you may have a sin issue. Jesus can touch that. He's helping you realize that this was a bad disease to have. The only worse disease you could have had is death. The fact that we're about to deal with this particular disease, it would be, if it's being able to be dealt with, it is equal to raising the dead. You're going to see in this context God's ability to deal with difficult and harmful situations without fear or hesitation. And if you call him in this situation, you'll see what his response is. Okay, so you keep reading for me from pick up where I was.
And a leper came to him and bowed down before him and said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean.
Now, here's the secret. The leper, the person with disease, came to him. You cannot keep your embarrassing disease and think that it's secret from Jesus. You've got to come to him, come to his power, come to his source. Come to his cross. Come to his altar. Whatever it means for you to get in contact with Jesus, you've got to come to him. And when you come to him, these lepers are not coming in pride. They're not even coming with this attitude that sometimes in Christianity, I got a right to the promises of God. And it's not that authoritative. It's not that you don't have authority, but it is a recognition that you are coming in contact with Jesus. They humbled themselves, and they made a unique confession. This is the first time within this gospel that the word Lord is used. This is the acknowledgement of Yahweh. This is the acknowledgement that this is more than a man. This is the acknowledgement that this is someone with power in heaven on earth, power of life and death. This is someone who can handle my situation. And you know that this is the case because it is not likely that someone with leprosy would even identify themselves, let alone come out publicly, let alone approach a person, let alone kneel to a person, and they wouldn't speak to somebody. They're doing everything out of sequence simply because there is a belief that Jesus is Lord, and he can solve their problem. So they're going past what people's opinion may be of them, and those who can hold them up or stop them up, or who might have something to say about their illness or the disease, or what Jesus cannot do, and say, oh, don't bother him. They say, no. I'm going to go to him, humble myself, and talk to him based on the authority that he carries. Remember, to me, this is an attitude of prayer. They call to Jesus. Remember, prayer is not just Jesus saying something to you. It's you saying something to him and it's him saying something back. So what did he say back to their response, to their request?
She said, I am willing, be cleansed.
He said, wait a minute. He said, they said, I know you can do it if you're willing. He said, wait a minute, I'm willing. How many of us have prayers like this? Lord, I need help, but I'm uncertain if you're willing to do something about my situation. I'm uncertain whether or not I've arrived at enough level of significance for you to impart your goodness or to lay your hands or to come into contact with me. I know that if you're willing, you can do something, but I want to know, in my case, are you? I mean, this is the question. Sometimes it's not about if you doubt God has the ability. We just sometimes think God doesn't have the willingness to do it for us. So we don't call on him. Let alone if there's been some type of heartbreak or disappointment in the past, we begin to give up on God's process of calling on him. Whosoever call on the name of the Lord should be saved. The first time you call on God and you don't feel like he saves you in the way that he ought to save you, then, you know, you get upset. Now, does this mean that every time you call and make a request, he answers and says, I'm willing to do it? No. There are times in the scripture when God will actually tell you, no, I'm not going to heal you. Y'all don't believe that? You believe that? Are you sure? You don't need a scriptural reference. Let me give you one just so you can learn your Bible. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 12. Start the 7th verse. Let's see this here. I didn't plan to go here, but I think you ought to just know that sometimes God say no. But it doesn't mean that he's not willing and more likely to say yes. Read. 2 Corinthians 12:7.
Because of surpassing greatness of the revelation, for this reason, to keep me from exalting myself, there was given me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me, to keep me from exalting myself.
Keep reading.
Concerning this, I implored the Lord 3 times and that it might leave me. And he has said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness.
Now, that's another way of saying no. No, I'm not going to do that for you. That mean I don't love you. It's just no. But in this case, we have to be willing to approach the Lord and receive a response. This is prayer. It's not just saying something to God. It's getting God's response and saying, I agree. With no news in Paul, 3 times, come on, Lord, do it. No. Come on, Lord, 3. No, come on, Lord, do it. Paul, I told you, my grace is sufficient. I'm going to perfect myself in your weakness. Now, none of us can determine whether we're that situation, but we have to call on him and ask. Now, go back to Matthew 8 and pick up reading where we left off.
And immediately his leprosy was cleansed.
Immediately it was cleansed. How long did it take Jesus to heal the leper? How long did it take Jesus to heal the leper? Did it say that Jesus prayed every scripture that he knew? Did it say that Jesus spoke a whole lot of words over him? Read what Jesus did.
And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one.
No, I wanted you to backtrack.
Oh, okay. Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, I'm willing, be cleansed.
Just touched him. Say, be cleansed. I know if you're anything like me and you've been around church a while and you've seen good healing line or a good prayer line, you know, you want to see some phenomenal stuff. And sometimes what you desire to see can prevent you from receiving what you should get. Because when they just came to Jesus with the right humble heart, Jesus said, you already where I need you to be. Be healed. Be cleansed. Receive what you said. It's as simple as it is. Anytime we as humans make the promises of God more difficult by adding to the word or taking away from the word, we're discrediting God's greatness and his power, and we're making our life more difficult. Read the rest.
And Jesus said to him, "See that you tell no one, but go, show yourself to the priest, and present the offering that Moses commanded as a testimony to them."
Now, all he told him to do is basically, now go be thankful. Your immediate response is to proclaim what Jesus has done for you. Don't tell anybody. Go to the priest. Go to the right people. Say, "Look, I got to report you something. I went back to the doctor, and I just want to thank God. I want to give him something." Watch this. Isn't it funny that worship and giving to God are almost always connected? It's impossible to say you're grateful and become stingy. What the leper's gonna give for their health? I mean, what can you do in exchange for your health? You think God bless you? He said, "And go give the offering assigned." Think for the poor, it was like a pigeon. It wasn't even something extravagant. It was something to just acknowledge. I'm going to the house of the Lord to thank him. The Bible says, "Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe you receive them and you shall." Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall. Prayer, supplication, with, make your known to the Lord. See, when you have the confidence of the lepers and you call on the Lord, when you got the confidence, he said, "Lord, I thank you. Lord, I'm coming to you. I'm humble, but I thank you." You still he's worthy of praise, whether he told you what he told Paul, no, or would he tell you what he told the leper? Be here. He's still worthy. And when you have an attitude of gratitude and a disposition of gratitude and a willing and a giving and a generous heart toward God, you don't understand the floodgates you open up. God is evaluating our heart. And I'll prove it on the next point of a man who is a Gentile who shows faith and confidence in who the Lord is, even though he's not been instructed like the Jewish community had been instructed, even though he doesn't know the pattern of Scripture. He can see the character of Jesus and the life of Jesus, and he has a response. Let's read the next part. This is about a person with confidence.
And when Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, imploring him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, fearfully tormented."
Now, I want you to know something about this centurion. A centurion is a Roman soldier, a leader of about 100 men. Romans were vicious killers. They were good at killing people. They were the ones that put Jesus to death, and they were crucifying people. During the time before Jesus got crucified, they had a pattern of crucifixion. And here is a centurion who was somehow, we would think in our mind, be adversarial toward Jesus, being approaching Jesus and requesting something from him. A couple of things I want you to point out here is, the approachable nature of Jesus. A leper can approach him. An enemy of his faith can approach him. The very people who he knows will be responsible for his agonizing death for humanity can approach him. He is sending us a message that he doesn't discriminate on how he'll heal or what he'll do. When you think that God is going to punish you by making you hang out with your illness as a punishment. That's not how he works. He will. He loves you so much. He loves humanity so much. He is here to deliver. He is here to set free. And there's something that has twisted society to think that Jesus needs to be a suspect, or we need to be suspicious of him, as if he's a God that inflates himself with things that you hope for, but he never does. Read.
And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him.
And I'm going to come. You think about the centurion is focused on his servant, his slave, who he has the right to kill. You got to understand this. This centurion has the right to kill a slave that is hurt. I love that Jesus can identify a good heart. He can identify a good man. You can see the characteristics of this man. He's concerned about his servant. As Christians, aren't we to be more like the centurion, who are more interested in our needs and in others' needs than our own? His petition is not about his own health or well-being. He is petitioning or praying to the Lord for someone else's good. Is your prayer time dominated by you? Your most recent problem, your most recent heartache, your most recent thing you're going through? Or are you having a Rolodex of people and their needs that are in your life that you are calling out to God saying, I know that you can do something for them if you come. I know you can handle it. I know. Does God, when he searches for a man to stand in the gap, does he find me? Does he find you? Or does he find us like his disciples who carry his name as disciplined ones, falling asleep on the job? Read.
But the centurion said, Lord, I am not worthy for you to come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed.
Look at this centurion. It is against the Jewish cultural tradition and, dare I say, law for a Jew to enter into the house of a Gentile. It would make him unclean. It's not correct. It's out of place. And the centurion cares, to me, how I read into the scripture, what care he has for this great healer, this Lord, that he would, no, don't come to my house. I'm not worthy of that type of visitation. I wouldn't want you to defile yourself, and I wouldn't want to enter into certain shame. Read what he did.
For I also am a man under authority with soldiers under me. I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. But when Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who were following, truly I say to you, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel. I say to you that many will come from east.
You can stop there. The centurion acknowledges with confidence a principle. Jesus, because of who you are, you can say the word and it's done. The scripture says that Jesus sends his word, and his word that is sent heals. Jesus says then he watches over his word to see it perform. Jesus says, or it says in Isaiah, so shall my word be that goes forth, and it shall not go out and return to me void, but it shall accomplish that whereto I send it, and it shall prosper wheresoever it goes. There is not a word that goes out from God's mouth that does not do what he commanded it to do. It's an assignment. He said, I got confidence in you, Jesus. I've got confidence in your ability. The Bible says, and if you don't, I'll give you the scripture reference later. It said Jesus was living in Capernaum. Y'all, I don't want y'all to look at me crazy. No, being from Bethlehem. No. just so you know, Matthew 4, 13, just for a little reference, because I'm going to help you see how he could have gotten confidence. Just read it real quick, Matthew.
And leaving Nazareth, he came and settled in Capernaum, which is by the sea, in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali.
That's where he was hanging out. So there was something that the centurion was doing, even secretly observing Jesus' life. And if you observe the move of God in people's life or whatever, you will have confidence. That's why that testimony is great. Why would he do that for him and then not do it for you? Observe what the Lord has been doing. Confidence. Finally, if all else fails and you don't really have a good style of calling on the Lord, and for some reason you don't have enough faith to have confidence by looking at the pattern in the life of Jesus, I got good news for you, the best news of the whole night. Jesus will come out of concern for you when you're in your great hour of need. Verse 14.
And Jesus came into Peter's home. He saw his mother-in-law lying sick in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she got up and waited on him.
I just love that. Just read it again, just to just see the intimacy of Jesus. So Jesus came into that home, saw what was going on, saw that he could solve it, and he said, I'm going to go touch her. Read it again, just so we can see it.
And when Jesus came into Peter's home, he saw his mother-in-law lying sick in bed with a fever. He touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she got up and waited on him.
He didn't even say much. He just saw and touched. He saw and touched. He just concerned. When you touch somebody, let them know you're concerned about them. Words along with touch are a dynamic thing. So when you see us laying on the hands and anointing with oil and the intimacy of that moment and touching someone, you don't have to view that as a something religious, and TV evangelists do that, and this is when people get pushed down, and this is when you discover that there's nothing. You don't do those things anticipating nothing. You have a pattern of scripture that lets you know when Jesus touches someone, they can be made whole. And the Bible says the works that Jesus has done, we'll do those same works and greater, because he put himself, he is the treasure in our earthen vessel. We can stir up the gift of God in our life. There's a gift of healing. There's a working of healing. And God will do it in your life. And let me tell you, when some one person, legit, we prayed, his life group prayed, they were given a different diagnosis, they were given a different outcome, but God intervened. He intervenes in a lot of different ways. Look at the last part of our message tonight and see what happened. See the wave of opportunity for God's miracle power to be seen happen. Read the last part.
And when evening came, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed, and he cast out the spirit with a word and healed all who were ill. This was to fulfill what was spoken through Isaiah the prophet. He himself took our infirmities and carried away our diseases.
He's going to fulfill his prophecy. If you're sick just because of physical illness, he can touch you. He can send a word to you. He can send a word to someone else, and you'll be healed. If you're demonized and paralyzed, and the devil will come out of you even tonight, come out of you or come off of you, oppressing you or possessing you, whichever you choose to think that the torment is coming from, that you can get rid of the devil tonight. He is real, and he is cunning, he is slippery, and he'll hang out as long as you let him hang out. If you're not bothered by him, then he won't bother you much. But the moment that you identify him, he'll tighten his grip. He'll act a little out on you. He'll whisper fear. He'll say stuff like, God's not going to do it for you, even though you just heard the word. God's not going to do it for you. Don't go up there. Don't have them pray for you. You know you don't believe that. You know what's going to happen to you? As soon as this word is sown and we begin to act on it by faith, there is something, there is someone, there is a scheme that has been sent out to steal the word. But the way you conquer that is you act on the word that you hear right away. And you say, God, if you said that, then I believe that. If you call you, you can heal me, whatever it is. If I have confidence, you can send the word and fix what's going on, not even in this room. And I, Lord, I know you're so concerned about me that you'll just show up and then the miracles can just start happening for everybody. Wasn't even talking about devils, but devils got to get out. This last part of the night is simple. Worship team, if you can please come back. We got a good 10 minutes to pray for you. And there's no reason if you have ailment in your body to assume you can handle it without the help of Jesus. But if you really understand that he is the maker of heaven and earth, he is the Lord God Almighty, he is the Lord that heals you, he is the Lord that watches over his word to perform it, he is the Lord that says, by his stripes, you are healed. He is the Lord. Part of salvation's promise is wholeness, wellness, soundness, nothing missing, nothing broken. If you have something missing or broken or infirmed in your body, then God has a promise to heal it. It's not about how anointed I am. It's about how promise-keeping he is. Even if I have a weakness, God himself has a strength. He is my strength in weakness. I'm just an elder that can anoint with oil, that can anoint some other people that can pray over you the prayer of faith and see a breakthrough, whether it's for you or for your mama that's not here, your grandmama that's not here, your child that's not here. Whatever might be going on in your life, Jesus cares about it. Call on him. Be confident today. Be strong in faith. Be strong in the Lord. And I thank you, Holy Ghost. I perceive that what God wants to do in you is greater than you. He is trying to empower this group of leaders to go out in your community and with boldness pray for the sick. When you see somebody in your job, say, I want to pray for you. Who told you you weren't qualified? If a centurion Roman soldier who is a murderer at the essence can get healing for his servant, how much more you and me who love him and serve him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Jesus tonight wants to do work in you. I don't know how he's been fighting you, but I know if the enemy will be fighting me on every turn, I know he'll be fighting you. And I'm fighting for your life right now. I'm fighting for you to have a life and have it to the full, have it abundantly. God has come that you might have abundant life. He's here to heal you. He's here to give you the miracle that you need. He's not the Bible says if you ask him for something good, a bread, he won't give you a stone. If you ask him for a fish, he won't give you a serpent. If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will God give to those who ask him? Call out to him and ask him. Maybe your situation is like the lepers today. You have dealt with it so long, you just think you're not going to get over it. God wants to heal you today. We don't have to be flamboyant, though it's all right if we are. We just have to be confident. And if we fail in confidence, he's so concerned, he'll show up and touch at least one person that'll get it going all over again.